So just, I'll get started because there's some people who are waiting, they've been waiting patiently, and it should be a minute and everyone will understand. Get to go here. Okay, so it's about getting there and staying there. I thought I would start with, I'm not sure how many people have been to Canada, know where Toronto is? Nobody. Okay. Yeah. So I just, I thought I would locate it on a map so you understand something about where Canada is, where Toronto is, because it's important. The geography is important. So you can see Toronto in the middle. Here we are. And here's New York, 1 hour and 15 minutes by air. And you can drive there in about 9-10 hours. Chicago is here, Miami, Dominican Republic, Los Angeles. Los Angeles is 5 hours by plane from Toronto. So it makes it accessible certainly to New York. Los Angeles is not a huge problem. We have had, I'll talk a bit more, but so television shows out of Los Angeles go to Vancouver, which is a Canadian city directly north, more than they go to Toronto. TV shows from New York, with New York production houses, tend to go to Toronto, and that sort of geography actually does matter. The other thing to understand here is Toronto is part of a province called Ontario. And in Canada, we have 10 provinces, and so Ontario sits in the middle, and it's the second wealthiest province, lots of manufacturing, and we, the City of Toronto and the Province of Ontario, work very, very closely together to make this thing work. The tax credits that I'll talk about are Ontario tax credits, and there's a national tax credit. There are no tax credits in the City of Toronto. Okay, so Toronto is a huge city. We have, in the city itself, 2.6 million people, and in the region around Toronto, 5.7 million people. It is a vibrant multicultural city where 42% of the people who live there are not from the city of Toronto, were not born in Canada, and are from around the world, speak multiple languages. There's over 100 languages spoken in Toronto, and they look more like this group of people than they do look like me. And that helps us as well because we're able to attract from around the world multilingual performers, multilingual productions, and make use of those global connections in selling the city and in making it important. The other thing about Toronto, some photographs, it sits on an enormous lake. So we have a waterfront, even though it's not the ocean, but Lake Ontario is one of the five great lakes in the world. It is 90 kilometers across to New York State, and it is almost 200 kilometers from one end to the other. So it's a giant lake with beaches, and it's a very attractive place. Because when you're trying to go after films and productions and producers, and for them, A-list actors, it's important that it's a place that people want to come. If you're going to spend a month or 2 months on a show, when you have a day off, a weekend off, you want to have something to do. We have 8,000 restaurants, we have museums, we have sports teams, we have jazz clubs, we have everything that you could possibly want. And so some of the stars, rather than going home on the weekend, will bring their families. Or Guillermo del Toro made Pacific Rim in Toronto. He was there for about 8 months making the film. He moved his family for the whole time, enrolled his children in school, because the city was a place that he wanted to live. So that's the kind of city that that Toronto is, and it's one of those things that is important as you think about the Dominican Republic and building your film industry here, is what are your strengths and how do you build on those things? And you need to know that being vibrant and active, a place that people want to come, is important in doing that attractive that attraction. Okay, so where are we right now? As Yvette said, Toronto is doing it just in the city of Toronto in terms of spend. This is not budgets of films. This is how much money is being spent here in Toronto, $1.1 billion a year. Last year, 68 features were made, 278 television productions, and we have full service labs. We have a deluxe lab, we have a Technicolor lab. We have 70 companies doing special effects, visual effects, animation, a workforce of 25,000 full-time crew and actors in the city. We have our own Pinewood Studios and a total of 90,000 square meters of space, 900,000 square feet of studio space in the city. Multiple equipment suppliers and lots of professional services. So we have the whole package. As I said before, this took about 30 years to build. So it doesn't happen overnight, but if you know what you want to be building, then you can start figuring out strategy. Okay. So just to break down some of those numbers, last year, this is the total production spending. We do, you can see, a small number of music videos. I think that's a place that you can always build business. And a place like this could be a good destination for a music video. And, you know, $5.8 million is not too bad. We have a lot of animation going back over decades, and last year did $103 million. Television commercials. Again, it's a good way to start, and last year, $131 million. At its peak, around 12 or 14 years ago, we were doing over $250 million in television commercials alone. That business, as you know, from just the way marketing happens, there's less money being spent on TV commercials, more money on social media and other things, so our share has gone down almost by 50%. And then major productions, $948 million. And if we go to the next slide, you'll see that major productions in there, we'll go next, is feature films, TV series, movies of the week, episodic TV, and so on. And in Toronto, so last year, 68 features for a total of $181 million. If you look at that, that's a lot of $3 million movies. So the average Canadian movie is now being made at about $2.5 million. So in Canada, Canadians make smaller budgets films. So you don't have to worry about, you know, big budget. Last year, we didn't have one of those huge blockbusters. 3 years ago, we did Pacific Rim and Total Recall all in the same year. And between them, they spent over $220 million. So there's always some fluctuation. You get some big movies in, but it's a lot of smaller movies, and you just keep moving them through. You can do that. You will see television business has really exploded in Toronto for some good reasons that I'll explain. And then movies of the week, 8 movies of the week for $5.6 million. 15 years ago, we would have done 40 or 50 movies of the week, and each of them would have spent probably $20 million. That business has pretty much gone away everywhere. They don't make that anymore. It's been replaced by a different format. So you have the big budget, American-style television shows that go out at anywhere between $3 and $3.5 million an episode. And they'll run 13 episodes, and that's replaced these miniseries movies of the week that we used to make a lot of. Okay, so just, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but you can see there's some fluctuations here in feature film spending. We had a terrible year in 2008 when the financial crisis came. had a huge impact on what movies were being made that year and what came. Our Pinewood studio actually opened in 2008, but really the first productions came in 2009, so that had a big impact. But you can see there are drops, and you need to manage those. Next, on TV, you can see that we've had steady growth through this whole period since 2005. And there's some fluctuations before 2005, but we've been on this steady growth, and it's partly that we have been extremely successful at attracting American big budget television films, and that started in 2007, 2008 with the Writers Guild strike, and I'll talk about capturing opportunities, but when the American writers went on strike, the U.S. networks were out looking for TV, and they bought two series, The Listener and a series called Flashpoint, that were made in Canada for Canadian television, and all of a sudden, the American networks thought, oh, we can make this stuff in Toronto. And you can see a steady growth after that of attracting big-budget American features. Okay. So I just, I've redone this on the next slide, but to give you an idea, basically if you want to think about how do you think about the film and television industry, somebody once said to me that it's a factory on wheels. Okay, a factory on wheels. It's just like making, you know, soap, widgets. And so this is an input-output model. And if we go to the next slide, you can see it a little bit better. But on the right-hand side, really, you have your pre-production, production, and post-production. And these are the various elements that are required in producing a quality film or TV production. And so when you're thinking about the development, and we did, and you will, then do you have all these things in place? And if you don't, how do we build those? How do we buy them? How do we attract them? How do you get at all these different things? So, you know, on the front side, you need people who are on the business side, the accountants, the legal people. Obviously, you need writers, editors. You need money. You need banks. All those sorts of things. That's all at the front to get your movies going, your film going. And then in the middle, and people focus very heavily on the production side, which is good, but if you don't have the front end, then you're not going to be doing a lot of your own. And the Canadian business has pretty much leveled out. We're doing half Canadian, half US and foreign now. That's changed. And so you want to have a domestic industry because it's what will sustain you over time. And then the foreign films that come in or the foreign TV is really in some ways gravy. So in the middle, studios, equipment, transportation, actors, crew, and so on. Those are all the pieces that you need in the middle. And then in post, do you have visual and special effects companies? Do you have animation? Do you have the graphics? Do you have logistics, display, marketing, and so on? Those are all the pieces that go into making a film. And luckily, in Toronto, we've managed to have all of that, and we have choices of all of that. But that's really been a big piece of the development, is making sure that we have all of these. You know, at the front end, we have three or four insurance companies that just deal with films, that know about insuring films. And it really makes it easy when someone comes to make a project that they know that they have somebody who really understands their business. It's not somebody who does automobile insurance, and then you come and he doesn't really understand, how do you do this, whatever. They know how to do the same with the lawyers. We have probably five or six legal firms, each with three or four or five lawyers who just do entertainment work. And so they understand about the contracts, they understand about it. It's very simple to make it work. This slide, just generally speaking, again, going back to what I said about the city, film and television is nested, it's in the middle of a larger framework. So part of being successful in film and television, you need to have a creative cluster, you need to have cultural industries. So if you have a theater community, if you have graphic artists, if you have designers and so on, visual artists, that helps. There's a crossover. And so at the same time, you want to try to be building and supporting that piece of the community. This is at a, you know, at a government level, at a policy level. But having those things, having a culture that supports film and television also helps to support the industry. And then just, as I said, you know, the quality of life, the general environment of the area that people are coming to are is also important. And so working on those things, making sure that it's safe was a big thing. People like to come to Toronto because it's very safe. The actors who come into town are not worried. If you have, we've lost films, everybody does. You have an actor, an actress who just says, I'm not going there. No, and that's it. If the film is built around a specific, you know, they want their A-list person for the marquee, and that person says, I'm not going there, it doesn't matter what they want to do, that the film's gone. It's going somewhere else. And so safety is a big thing. Different people have different interests. Restaurants sometimes are really, you know, or do you have a 5-star hotel? That kind of stuff. So all of that's important in moving forward, and those are all things that we've been working on in Toronto for the last 40 years. In 2003, in the spring of 2003, Toronto had a, I'll call it an outbreak, of a disease called SARS, a respiratory disease. And it was all over CNN, and people were wearing masks, and it was more frightening at the beginning than Ebola, than the Ebola crisis that's going on right now. People didn't know how you got it, people got sick. At its peak, we had about, not that many, maybe 30 people who were infected, but they weren't sure how they got infected. It was all over again in the American press. We had a film that was going to camera, Shall We Dance, with Richard Gere and others. It was in the city, he was in the city. They pulled it and they moved it to another city overnight. They had been in pre-production for over a month. They pulled their sets, they pulled their people, they moved the crew, they moved the cast, they just left the city. And so 2003, we lost half of our business. We lost over $500 million in 1 year of business. It started a trend with Toronto was much more successful than Vancouver. A lot of TV shows moved from Toronto to Vancouver, and it took us about 6 or 7 years to start getting them back. So following up on that, we thought we need a strategy. We need to figure out how do we move forward? What are we gonna do? We had all these things in place, but how do we tweak the system? Because we went from over $1 billion to $600 million overnight. And it looked like we were just gonna keep sliding. So we did a study, and the theme here was, you know, basically, if we do it right, then we're gonna be better than New York and Los Angeles and London. And that really was, you know, so we were looking at those two places. We were looking at those three places because we were a $1 billion industry. It doesn't make any sense to target in the Dominican Republic to say, well, we wanna be New York. That might be too much. You know, maybe there's an interim step because you can get really frustrated if you try to be something that you're not going to be. So maybe you want to look around and say, okay, there's a model over there. We want to be like Miami, maybe. Maybe we want to be like Charlotte, North Carolina. We want to be a place that's maybe making $200 million, $250 million in films a year. And that's something we do. And when we get there, we'll have another target. But you know, overstretching is really not the best place to start. So we stretched a bit. We think we're as good as those places. What was the strategy really? Essentially, it focused on four areas. We had to look at our incentives again, because money speaks. We had to look at policy and regulation. What was the government doing? How were we intervening in the system? How are we supporting the system? We had to look at aligning and coordinating inside the system, in amongst companies, between companies, the policies in companies. We had to look at that, and we had to look again at marketing and promotion. We had companies that used to come to Toronto that were going to other places, and how were we going to attract them to come back? What did we need to do to gain their attention? So that was essentially the focus of the strategy. What do we do there? Okay. So I just try to, you know, make it a bit simple. Our recipe always, and I think this is where everybody can do this, every project is excellent. You always do your best. If it's, you know, everybody's best is a bit different. You know, baseball, you know, stars or soccer stars or people who are elite in whatever field they're in, they have good days and bad days. But you want to try for your best day all the time. So excellence, and then in this business, affordability, and in our case, no surprises. That if you say you're going to do something, you need to do it. Because it's the unpredictable stuff that really gets you. You have a show comes to town, and they're expecting something, and it doesn't happen. They immediately tell 10 friends. And then all of a sudden, you know, everybody, because everybody's trying to get your business, right? So everybody in Los Angeles now is saying, oh, I heard in Toronto, you know, they promised me, you know, 10 drivers, they only had 3 drivers. You know, I couldn't make my shot because the crane didn't work. Whatever, right? You never want to have any of that happen, because if something good happens, somebody phones their wife, and the wife might call somebody else, and one person hears. If something bad happens, they tell everybody. So you want to, so excellence, affordability, and no surprises. And I'll spend a little bit of time, but you know, as I said before, know and build on your strengths. So be really clear, go back to that chart and say, okay, what are we really good at? And let's build on those things. Those are the things that we can market, we can promote. Be honest about your weaknesses and work on those. But when somebody comes, don't overpromise. You know, if you can't offer something, then don't offer it. That's something to work on. Recognize and seize opportunities is really critical. That somebody who, as a community, thinking about and recognizing that something is an advantage that you can take hold of, is really important to mobilize and be ready and to seize those moments. And often you miss them. And you find out later, oh, I could have done this or I could have done that. And so that's really, you know, critical there. Managing your threats, it makes sense. Just do your best at that. And then a big piece of our recovery, our strategy, was government working with industry, and almost more importantly, industry working with industry. That if your various companies that you have are gnawing away at each other, are interfering with each other's success, are not, I mean, there's competition all the time. But if somebody gets the job, the other people should help them. Because ultimately, it just makes things work better. And the next time you get a job, if there's a lot of infighting, then things start to fall apart. It's an uncomfortable kind of an environment. People like to know this is a place where people cooperate, people get along, because particularly we found on animation, visual and special effects, in that area of the business, which has grown dramatically, and we're trying to grow it even more, you might have a studio with 15 people, and you get a big job, and all of a sudden you need 20 more people. And how are you going to get them? You're basically going to subcontract to somebody else, because you don't get them, you can't train them, you can't attract them quickly enough to deal with the job. So there has to be that movement across people. People have to cooperate with each other. And that was a big piece of the strategy in putting it in place. Okay. So just, you know, as I said, 60 years in the film business, we have all the pieces, production, post-production, animation, special visual effects. We have lots of flexibility and depth. We service our clients really well. We deliver great product all of the time. I'll get into tax credits. Innovation, we're really good in Toronto at trying to make things, whether it's a vehicle or it's a new program or something, we're looking for ways to innovate so that we're ahead of the curve. And if somebody else has picked something up, then we're amongst the first to adopt. So we were making 3D films in Toronto before most other places on the planet. people just said, okay, we got to figure this new technology out. Maybe James Cameron being Canadian got people thinking a bit more about it, but we had a camera company in Toronto that built a rig for 3D cameras, and he started making that available to people. And just those kinds of things. So look around, stay ahead of the curve. It's important. Okay, and as I said, no surprises, and we have lots of government supports. Like you, we have a national agency. It provides funds for Canadian productions. We have an agency, Telephone Canada, that manages that side, but is also our global marketing partner. We have more than 50 co-production agreements. So a Canadian company and a company from any of 50 countries can come together and make a film, make a production, and benefit from the tax credits or the tax regime in their two countries, and it works really well. So we have these things going on. If you don't, Canada and the Dominican Republic, interestingly, do not have a co-production agreement. Canada is not engaged in making more, but they just signed one with India last year, so maybe some opportunities. It had been maybe 10 years since they had an agreement, because there were just so many of these things, they just went, whoa, maybe we don't need any more. But it does give two companies coming together in two different countries an opportunity to share certain tax benefits that you don't get if you're a service production. So the government in Canada has been active. In fact, going back, the National Film Board was created 75 years ago, the first sort of national film agency. And in that time, you probably know that they've made 13,000 productions and won over 5,000 awards, a number of Oscars and awards everywhere around the world. So that's the kind of tradition that we had. Okay, so go forward. So as I said, these are the components. The creative cluster is really important. You build off on your media and broadcasting, because again, there's synergies there. People who are doing television commercials, or people in the telecom business, people who are advertising executives, they know how to do things for the industry. Theater feeds back and forth. The schools, we have 5 universities and 5 colleges, all with programs in film, television, animation, gaming, and so on. So this is all going on in Toronto right now. Okay, and I may just say, I don't know if you know, but Maya software and Houdini software were both developed in Toronto. So back to the innovation side, probably the two major pieces of software used in animation and effects. IMAX theaters were developed in Toronto. And so on, and our festivals. So you all know about the Toronto International Film Festival, but in Toronto we have more than 70 film festivals a year, 70 every year. And what's important about a festival like this here and other festivals is that it gives first-time filmmakers an opportunity to show their films. It creates a push for the industry. It's an opportunity for the industry as well to sell itself to the world. And in the case of TIFF in particular in Toronto, it gives us a chance to get the stars there. And there's a lot of, we get to sell the city as well as create these connections between producers and directors. But just the fact that people come and they go, oh, this is a nice place. I could work here. Or they come and visit your studio, or they go and visit an animation company or whatever. So these festivals, like this festival, is a really good place to begin, and it's part of your marketing package. And you need to understand that it's a big piece of the marketing package. And in our case, it's also a huge financial generator. All of the film festivals together create about $150 million in economic impact in the city, so TIFF and the others. So there's a lot of money. During TIFF, 30,000 hotel rooms are booked every night for 10 days, as an example. Restaurants and taxis and flowers and all of that. So that they're important for you. So the government, I said the government. So I was responsible for the Toronto Film and Television Office, TFTO. The TFTO basically is a, there's a staff of 12 people, and our job is primarily on the ground fulfillment. We are there to make a filmmaker happy, whatever they need. We're sort of the Uber location manager. So we issue all the permits for all location shoots. We make sure that the police are notified and they're on board, fire, transportation system, the public transit, whatever. We make sure everybody's okay. We make sure that the local politicians are okay. We make sure that the local politicians and the neighbors are not fighting, that business owners are not unhappy. They can be unhappy, but they aren't going to be unhappy with the film company that's now parked 20 units in front of their store and no one's getting into it. So that our job is to make sure basically that everybody is happy. We provide a single film officer for every film, so they have a contact. They issue the permits. They talk to the location people every day. And you know, if things get a little wacky, then you know, I might get a phone call from some producer who's really unhappy, and then you go and do whatever to make them happy. So that sort of fulfillment, the office as well, along with the province, I said, we promote Toronto, we go to Cannes, we go to Berlin, we go to New York, we go to LA, and in the LA sphere, because you know it's where the big studios are, we have a full-time office and a full-time staff person in Los Angeles, in their time zone, there to answer questions 24/7. So that was really important for us. And we monitor government policy, we make recommendations, we lobby on behalf of the industry to change rules and regulations as we need to. Work with the local festivals, as I said, and we also try to work with industry to make sure that they can grow and expand. So that's what our office does. And at the province, it's some of the same stuff. Together we have that office in LA. A big piece, we have a digital locations library. You can go and look for it. We have over 130,000 images of the city and the province. You can go on, you can make your own scouting package, or if you're an LA producer and you want to be doing a Western, and you send us and say, we want to do a Western, we want this kind of a look, we'll actually go out and build a package for you based on our understanding of locations and show you before you even want to come, this is what you can do, these are the places. And then if somebody is serious and they have the money, we even pay for a scout. So we'll have a director, a producer, sometimes the art director will fly to Toronto, we'll put them up for 2 or 3 days and we'll show them locations. I know you do some of the same here. So that's what we do on the ground for filmmaking. Okay, and that's a little picture. I don't know if you've seen Reds, but that was it was quite a bit of fun and very noisy. All right. So just I talked about you know these sorts of things, and I'll tell you just a little bit here. So when I talked about, you know, so those are the strengths. Weaknesses. Like you, we're not the United States. So what did we do? The big thing that we did initially was we got an IATSE local. Because the major studios have agreements with IATSE. They want to work with IATSE people. It made it really simple, so we got a local. They do the same kind of work, so it's seamless. You show up in Toronto, and the crew are just like the crew that you had in LA or New York or Chicago or wherever else you made a film, they're the same. So we got around it that way. Our distance to Los Angeles was an issue. We started working a lot with New York, and we made sure that it was going to be possible through the LA office for people in Los Angeles to be able to phone at what was 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock Toronto time, be able to call somebody in Los Angeles. It was okay. It was made it possible for them to have someone come to their office that day or the next day, so it felt like Toronto was a lot closer to them. And that was a way we got around being too far from LA. Initially, we didn't have a big multi special use purpose-built studio. We had retrofitted spaces like everywhere else, and we attracted Pinewood Studio through some credits around tax increment financing, some other things that the city did. We gave them a piece of land, and like you, we have a great Pinewood Studio. It's a little bit bigger, but it's, you know, for the first time we had a stage that was built as a stage. It wasn't a factory that they pumped up the roof and did some other stuff. And that was really helpful because we didn't have a place because, unlike you, we have winter. So you can't do a location shoot in you know, late December, January, February, or March. There's too much snow. It's too cold. You don't want to work without your gloves and your mitts. So big purpose studio is important. On the opportunity side, the Ontario government had an educational TV channel. And one of the things that it was dedicated to, and I don't know if you have it here, Saturday morning cartoons. So during the week, they had regular programming. And in Canada, certainly when I was growing up and still, Saturday morning was all cartoons. And most of them came out of the United States. You had the Roadrunner, you had Mickey Mouse, you had the Jetsons, you had Yogi Bear. I don't know what you have here. But TVO decided that they wanted some Canadian content. So they started making Saturday morning cartoons. And out of those cartoons came a company called Nelvana. It's now in 50 countries. It has, what are some of the shows you might know? I don't know. I'm sure they're here. Blanked on that. But they have cartoons in 50 countries. We have a company called ARC now in Toronto, in some ways as a result of that cartooning. And they did Romeo and Juliet. It was a full-length feature animation. We ended up with a Disney studio in Toronto for about 5 years because we had animators and they were used to doing animators. Sheridan College, which is well known as an animation school, really grew up as a result of the Saturday morning cartoons. So you want to take those opportunities and build on them wherever they are. We picked up on that. Film festivals, I talked about the Writers Guild strike. I also talked about we managed to sell TV and that had a huge impact. And the changing TV models now, we've been very successful with shows like The Borgias, The Tudors, where we're doing those in co-production with Ireland, where all the location shooting is going on in Irish castles and horses and all that. And in order to fulfill the requirement of the co-production agreement, all the back end is being done in Toronto. So all of the special effects and visual effects are all done in Toronto. And so we're bringing that business in, and that's really grown. I talked a little bit about some of the threats. Runaway production, the Americans hate that all the movies are being made in Toronto. And so for the longest time, we made movies. Chicago would be a really good example. Went on to win a number of Oscars. And we never told anyone that it was made in Toronto. So we just decided it was better to have the business than to make a big splash because the pushback was so hard that we just went, okay, just, you know, and they were happy to come and make their movies in Toronto. And as long as we sort of didn't tell anybody, the unions didn't do too much damage and, you know, they would keep coming. So, you know, it was very hard to have an Oscar-winning movie, you know, I think they won 4 Oscars, and not say made in Toronto. Just everybody, you know, you in your mouth, and that's what you know. But we did that, so Runaway, we had to deal with that. SARS, I talked about rising Canadian dollar. Right now, the dollar is at about 87 cents. We were at $1.03 a year ago. And so as it was going up, we became less and less competitive. And so what were we gonna do? There were certain charges that the city applied, not related to permits, but if you needed to have a garbage crew from the city come and clean up, we would charge you for the time of the people on the street. We pegged the dollar. We just said, okay, no matter what the exchange rate is like, we're going to say, we're going to stabilize the exchange rate at 87 cents. So we were discounting at one point 16 cents on every dollar spent. So we just said, don't worry about the dollar on these things. And it wasn't a lot of money, but it was really surprising that in a show that might spend $25 million, they were really excited that they would save $10,000 or $15,000. So in some ways, it was just making that little effort and saying, look, you know, we're doing what we can. So, you know, looking at that kind of thing, immigration rules, we bring a lot of talent in, the above the line talent. We bring in some keys, some, you know, the leads on cinematographers or camera people sometimes, depending on the directors sometimes have their crew. And basically we have some rules in Canada where if you can hire a Canadian, you're supposed to hire a Canadian. So this got to be a bit conflictual. And basically after quite a bit of time, we made some agreements that it was better to have maybe 500 people working than not having anybody working. So let the three people in that you didn't want. This was a major cognitive, you know, piece of work that we had to do with government. I was a government official, but you know, the Canadian government just didn't get it. You know, their rules were their rules. And we said, this is stupid. So it was a lot of work, but we started having special permits issued and things like that just to make it easy to make the sale. So we wouldn't let a whole crew in. Part of the issue with making films with India, in fact, is that they have a very family-oriented way of making their films. They have their group. And so a filmmaker comes and he wants to bring 40 crew. And he'll hire 10. We can't fix that. But if you know, want to bring 6 or 7 or 10 people, we can make that kind of thing work. And it's important. That's where government can, working government to government, you can do some of that stuff. Right now, a bit like you, but we're sometimes worse. We have a lot of congestion. And so we have a lot of location shoots. And what are we going to do about that? That's a big problem. It takes a long time to go from point A to point B to move your base camp or move your equipment for a day. And so we really do need to work on those issues or we're gonna find ourselves losing out to other places where it's easier to move around. Okay, 10 minutes? Okay, we'll go. So just tax credits, as you know, It's about money. You cannot be more expensive than everywhere else. But I think it's important, when I said an unbeatable value, okay, being the lowest cost place often isn't good. So we are not the lowest cost place. What we sell is value. And there's places in the United States they call them one-time states. They call them one-time states because they have really great incentives. They have nothing else. So you bring your production there, and it's going to be cheap, cheap, cheap. Except that your cameraman gets sick, and it takes 2 days to get a new cameraman in because you have to fly them in from wherever, right? They have three lights, one gets broken, whatever. They have no infrastructure at all, and it looks like it's going to be really cheap. And as long as everything works perfectly, it works out. But things never work perfectly on a film. So you do yourself more damage, you know, trying to be the cheapest place, and then again, you know, not being honest about what you get. So it's about value, and I think you want to build your value proposition, and that's been really important for us. One of the things that we've done in Toronto, we've been lucky, is that we don't have caps on spending. So in New York, it's not bad. In California, they have a problem, and in many other places, they have a problem where they have a fixed budgeted amount for the tax credits. And either they have a lottery in some cases, so you're never quite sure if you're going to get the credit or you're not going to get the credit. And I know in Georgia, it got to be really bad where you might start your production and you were supposed to get 80% of this amount of money. And then the state runs out of money while you're producing. So instead of giving you, let's say, $100,000, they only have 40. We're really sorry. You build your whole budget on getting this $100,000 and now they tell you they're not going to give it to you. So we don't have any caps. When you come, whatever you spend, you get your 25%. And everybody gets it. And if this year we spend $85 million, it's 85. If next year it's 92, it's 92. If the year after it's 68, it's 68. It doesn't matter. Everybody, when we tell you you're going to get 25% of your below-the-line expenses, it's 25%. There's no cap. And that's an important feature. So the idea that you have a fixed budgeted amount that you might exceed, and then it's unclear what's going to happen, causes problems. So in Toronto, when you go to camera, you know exactly, based on your spend, what it is that you're going to get back from the government. And you can go to a bank, and they'll give you that money, because they know it's coming. In many places, you do that calculation, and you go to a bank, and they say, oh, we'll give you 50 cents on the dollar. Well, what am I supposed to do with the rest of it? We don't know. And that gap financing is very expensive. So that's a really important strategy that we've had. We've had tax credits for about 14 years, and they've only gone up. They've never changed except to go up. So we have stability in the credits, and that's also important. Places where the legislature, your government, the parliament is talking about, are we going to have tax credits? We're not going to have tax credits. People don't want to come. So stability in that is really, really important. So, no uncertainty, no surprises, no caps, no limits on the number of productions. This is, really important. The amounts of money matter, but those other elements are really key. And then, under-promise and over-deliver. Okay, tell somebody they're going to get two of something and give them three. Don't tell them they're going to get 2.2 and give them two. Just a little, if you don't deliver a little, then people are unhappy. If you tell them you're going to give them this and you give them more, they're very happy, even though, it might not be very much. The other thing that we've done is we stack our credits. So we have a production credit and we have a digital animation credit, and you can apply both of them so that instead of just the 25%, you can get 25 and 20. So for a bunch of technical reasons, it doesn't add up to 45, but it doesn't matter. But you can get both credits and you can build on them. So depending on the kind of production you have, you can augment the amount of money you're getting from the government. And that was another feature that we had. Okay. So the result is that we have great television. I don't know, you may have seen some of these shows. Big Canadian show, Degrassi. I don't know, we had it for like 15 years that's been going around. Flashpoint was an important breakthrough show for us with the Americans. The Tudors, the Borgias, this co-production model. Lots of American TV, Rookie Blue, what else is down there? Warehouse 13, Covert Affairs, and on and on and on. On the feature film side, we had some of these, some of the more recent ones, but Red, we have all the Resident Evil movies have been made in Toronto, Pacific Rim, Dream House, as I said, Romeo and Juliet, RoboCop, and so on, all being made in Toronto. And I thought, since I've been talking so long, that I'd show you, so we did a lot of animation. So this is, we have an animation society. Companies have come together, animation visual effects companies, into an organization called Queso, and they cooperate. And so they did this for you today. It's not working. All right. You want to go back the other way? Just a little bit about, we are thinking about the future. So we all have to worry about globalization. We all have to worry about increased competition and sticking around with that. Technology, gaming, opportunities with gaming, multiple platforms, applications. There's a gazillion things out there. All the students here know more about apps than I do, but that's a place that it's going. The new financial models, we need to figure out that. Don't have the answers. And just fundamental changes to how we make movies in the future is coming. So thank you very much.
Octavo Festival de Cine Global Dominicano, porque yo soy loco con el cine. ¿Y tú?